Welcome to phase two, part three of my developing a match grade load series. If you remember, we printed up some batch forms for 16 different batches of ammunition. We're going to be using Hornady A Max and Hornady 178 grain A Max and 168 grade match bullets for these batches. We'll be using both IMR 4895 and Hodgson Farragut powders, Winchester large rifle primers, and of course the Hornady match cases and the Winchester cases that we fire formed in phase one. And in phase two, part two, we went through and sized, trimmed, set the head spacing, did all of those things. So the cases are ready to go, and we're basically ready to start loading. Now, I did make a couple of changes. One, I decided instead of making 20 rounds of each batch, I'm only going to make 10 rounds. A couple reasons for that. 10 rounds will give me 2 5-shot groups with each batch, which is plenty. And also, these are relatively expensive bullets. So rather than making a bunch of extra bullets that I really don't need, or using up a bunch of expensive bullets that I really don't need in cartridges, I decided to swap them down to 10 per batch instead of 20. Now, the other change I made is, if you remember, we decided that I was going to size my neck down to 338 inches neck diameter, and with a 15 thousandths neck wall thickness, that gives me a 308 inch inner neck diameter. I decided I think I want to have a little more tension on it rather than try to put a taper crimp and get the tension that way. I want to size the neck down a little bit. So I sized the necks down to 336 thousandths. That'll give me a 1 thousandths tension all around between the case and the bullet. So those are the two changes I made from the last couple of videos. 10 rounds per batch and 336 thousandths neck size instead of 338 thousandths. Now, before everybody starts commenting, saying you should use XYZ powder or ABC bullets, you know, they're so much better, yada, yada, yada. Bear in mind, this is just our first pass. We're going to be using a variety of different bullets from Spear, Nosler, Barnes, etc. We'll be using other powders from Hodgson, IMR, Alliance, so on and so forth. So we'll be swapping these out. We're basically just trying to compare what this group does versus other groups and try to determine what my particular rifle likes best. And once we've done that, then we'll move on to phase three and do a little more fine tuning of those particular loads. So we're ready to start loading some cartridges. Let's get going. First step, of course, is to put primers in all my cases. Now, I got some questions from a couple folks about my last video. If you recall, we used our primer pocket uniformer to make sure that all of our primer pockets were at least 0.125 inches deep. And questions were, of course, you know, why did you pick 0.125? Why that number? Well, I didn't just pull it out of my sphincter. If you measure a large rifle primer, you'll see that it is exactly 0.125 inches, so, or in depth. So I made sure that all of my primer pockets were 0.125 inches, and that's why we use the primer pocket uniformer for that. Now, there's a lot of different ways to put primers in cases. This is one way. It's a hand primer. This is Hornady's version. A lot of companies have these. Essentially, it's got a primer turning plate where you can shake the primers on here. It'll flip them over so that the anvils are pointing up. I have the number one shell plate inserted into the top here. And essentially what I do is I shake a primer into the hole, I put a case into the shell holder and squeeze, and I get a prime case out. Very easy to do, goes very quick. Thing I don't like about it is that it's possible to get a primer not in there quite all the way, and it won't come out of the shell holder, and you have to squeeze a little bit more. And oddly enough, being a hand tool like this, you can't feel the primer going into the case as well as you can with some other devices. So I like to use the priming system on my single stage. Now you can check out my video on the Hornady single stage press to see exactly how the priming system works. But essentially I bring it up to the top. It'll drop a primer into the primer cup here. I'll put a case in on the downstroke. And then I can push forward on the handle, and that'll prime the case for me. And oddly enough, as opposed to the hand priming tool, I can feel the primer go in. I get a nice positive feeling out of it. So I know that it's gone in properly and all the way. Missed that one. Like I said, I can feel it when it doesn't happen. Goes, I think, just as quick with the single stage as it does with the hand priming system. It's also very easy to use. Goes very quick. Of course, I fumble now that I said it's really quick, but that's really all there is to it. Bring it up to the top, grab a primer, put a case in, seat the primer, drop the case, so on and so forth. Up to the top, primer, case, prime it, and it goes very quick. You get a nice solid seat out of it. And I can feel it better. Again, there's lots of ways to put primers in cases, but this is my favorite way to do it. Now, before I rush on to the next step, I'm going to make sure that all my primers are seated properly. You can feel for a high primer just by rubbing your finger on it. You shouldn't be able to feel that primer on there. A good second safeguard is to put a flat edge against the head of the case, and you should be flat up against the case all the way across, and that'll ensure that your primer isn't you don't have a high primer. Now I did take one case and I put a high primer in here on purpose so I could show you here. If you can rock the straight edge like that, that means that you've got a high primer. It's not seated quite all the way in there. And if you feel it, you can kind of feel that it's not quite in there all the way. So all you really have to do is put it back in your press, push it down, and now we have, you know, a well-seated primer. Okay? So I check all my cases to make sure I don't have any high primers anywhere. Before we move on to the next step. Now, what is a high primer exactly, and why is a high primer so bad? Now, what is a high primer exactly? Well, simply put, a high primer is a primer that hasn't been pushed all the way into the primer pocket, so it's kind of hanging out a little bit. Now, on the illustration here, it's kind of exaggerated, you know, for illustration purposes, but if you had a primer sticking this far out, I'm sure you'd notice it. But typically, they're only, you know, a few thousandths, you know, 5 thousandths or so out of the back of the head of the case. And you can't really notice it unless you you look very closely or you use a straight edge to verify that the primer is all the way in there. Now,
Some of the problems associated with a high primer, the first and least serious really is a misfire. Now, when the firing pin comes in contact with the primer, what it does is it dimples the cup of the primer, and that causes the inside of the cup to come in contact with the anvil, and it kind of pushes that anvil. The anvil creates a little spark that ignites the flammable material inside the primer, which then shoots through the flash hole, ignites your gunpowder, and the firearm discharges. Now, what could happen when you have a high primer is the firing pin will simply push the primer into the primer pocket all the way. And what that does is cause kind of a cushioning effect where the firing pin doesn't hit the primer hard enough to dimple it enough to hit the anvil and cause the cartridge to go off. So you end up with a misfire. And if you were to take that cartridge out and take a look at the primer, you'd see that the dimple on the primer is not nearly as deep. It's much shallower than on a cartridge that fires normally. So, misfire, and it's possible for the cartridge to go off normally, and you'd never even know that you had a high primer there. But with a high primer, you run the risk of having a misfire like this. Now, one thing I'll say about a misfire, if you pull the trigger and all you hear is a click, don't immediately assume that it's a misfire. You could have a hang fire. Now, a hang fire is a delayed discharge. Kind of an unexpected delay between when you pull the trigger and when the cartridge goes off. I've seen hang fires anywhere from 2 seconds to around 10 or 12 seconds before the cartridge went off. So if you pull the trigger, hear nothing but a click, don't immediately assume it's a misfire. Keep the firearm pointed downrange in a safe direction for about 30 seconds or so before you pull that cartridge out of there. If you clear the firearm right away after a misfire, that cartridge could still be in the process of igniting, and it could go off in your face, it could go off in your hand if you pick it up and they're looking at it. So don't always assume you have a misfire. Could be a hang fire. Keep that firearm pointed downrange. Now, the second problem you can have with a high primer is a slam fire. And this is a little more serious. What happens is, here we have our bolt on the right there. You'll have to forgive my complete lack of artistic talent here. But here we have our bolt pushing the cartridge into the chamber and goes into battery. Now, what can happen, especially on military firearms that have a free floating firing pin, or maybe you have a weak firing pin spring, something like that, what could happen is when that bolt hits up against that chamber and stops suddenly, the firing pin could continue moving forward and strike that primer. So the cartridge could go off even though you haven't pulled the trigger. This can happen on, any auto-loading kind of a firearm that either has a weak spring or free-floating firing pin, that sort of thing. So it happens, say, on an AR-15, for instance, when you pop a magazine in, you push the bolt release, the bolt comes forward. If you have a high primer, a slam fire is more likely because that firing pin may still come forward on a normal cartridge, but it doesn't come forward far enough or hard enough to hit the primer. But when you have a high primer, it's more likely to come in contact with that primer and fire that cartridge. So a slam fire is a much more serious event. If you're loading your firearm and it goes off as soon as you hit the bolt release, where's that firearm pointed? That's why it's so important to keep your firearm pointed in a safe direction at all times, even when you're loading or, while you're firing. If the bolt comes back and then strips another round off the magazine and puts it in the battery, you could have a slam fire then. You'll get more than one shot per trigger pull. And in some really severe cases, the thing could go into full automatic on you, although that's extremely rare. So slam fire, that's another problem that's caused by high primers. Now, the most serious problem is an out-of-battery detonation. This is when the cartridge has not gone into the chamber all the way, the bolt has not gone into battery and locked into place there, and the cartridge goes off. And what happens here with a high primer, as the bolt is pushing the cartridge into the chamber, the high primer here could get crushed by the bolt or even the firing pin if the firing pin's not locked. And what can happen is the primer gets crushed, the cartridge goes off at that point, and it's not in battery, and you could have hot gases and shrapnel come flying out of the breech. I've seen one out-of-battery detonation. It was during a three-gun match, and fortunately the shooter wasn't injured. It just had some burn marks around the firearm, around the ejection port. But it's a very serious problem having an out-of-battery detonation, and it is more likely to occur when you have a high primer in your case or in your cartridge.
The next step, of course, is to start dropping powder charges in our cases. Now, I've got all my powder charging toys out, kind of to make a point. You can check out my videos on Hornady powder scales and Hornady powder measures for an in-depth discussion on each piece of equipment you see here. The point I want to make basically is when you're developing a match grade load, now let me define match grade. I'm talking about match grades as in a high power rifle match where fractions of an inch mean the difference between coming in first and coming in last. For that kind of precision, you need to use a powder scale, not a powder measure. A powder measure just simply does not have the kind of accuracy or the kind of consistency that you need for this kind of match grade load. They're great for putting together loads for plinking or for matches, say, like USPSA or Steel Challenge or something like that, where you're shooting at a 12-inch target, and it doesn't really matter where you hit the target as long as you hit it. Three-gun matches and that sort of thing. But for a high-power rifle match, a powder measure just simply doesn't do the job. Now, that's not to say that a powder measure can't be used when putting together a match-grade load. But the other point I wanted to make was that regardless of the equipment you have, now even if all you have is a miniature scale, something like this, a little pocket scale, and a trickler, you can develop match grade loads. You don't need the big expensive stuff. Of course, a little trickler like this would take quite a while to drop a 40 grain charge with a little trickler like that. For something like that, you may want to go with maybe a Hornady quick trickle that'll charge your cases a lot faster, drop 40 grains of powder a lot faster. Now, the other way you can go too is you can set up your powder measure to drop close to the charge that you're trying to get. Basically, then drop it into your powder tub, measure it, and then use your powder trickle to trickle a little bit of powder in if it's a little bit short. So you might want to set up your powder measure to drop charges that are just a little bit under what you're looking for, and then use your powder trickler to top it off, so to speak. So whether you've got a pocket scale, or you've got a bench scale, or you've gone all out and you've got yourself an auto charge scale, really doesn't matter. The only difference is going to be in time. You know, the using the little pocket scale with a little trickler probably take you longer to put together the loads than it would say with a bench scale on a in a quick trickle, or using a bench scale with a powder measure. And now I'm going to be using my auto charge for my video here, but I wanted to kind of show you some of the options that you have. You don't have to have the expensive gear to do a match grade load. Okay, you can get by with, you know, a $25 scale and a $5 trickler, and you can drop match grade loads no problem. Next step is to charge the cases. Now, before I do that, I take a few safety precautions. Besides the obvious, no smoking, no source of flame, things like that. I do normally carry or have a lighter on my bench for my annealing machine to light up the torch. So this goes away during the reloading process or during the charging process. Whenever I'm working with powder, I take a few precautions. I also have a fire extinguisher. Although if the powder goes up, I kind of doubt I'll have time to to get to the fire extinguisher before things get out of control. So any source of sparks or flame, open flame, things like that get removed. Now, if you live in a very dry climate and you have a static electricity problem, if you get zapped when you touch the doorknob, things like that. In my case, I live in Florida. It's fairly humid here, and I don't normally have a big static problem. But my reloading shop here is carpeted, so I have noticed on occasion that when I touch a doorknob, I get a little zap, especially during the winter. So what I've done is I have a grounding rod on my workbench, and what I do is I take one of these little grounding straps, a wrist strap, people who work on sensitive electronics, things like that, wear one of these. And what I'll do is I'll go ahead and clip my ground strap to my grounding rod. So now I'm grounded, and static electricity will not be a problem. The grounding rod on my bench is connected to the house electrical system ground, so that'll reduce the possibility of static. Another thing that I do, now I'm working with two different kinds of powder here. I've got Hodgson Varget and IMR 4895 for this first batch. I'm going to do the Hodgson Varget first. So I've removed the IMR 4895 powder from the bench altogether. I don't want to accidentally pour the wrong powder into the wrong can. Last thing you want to do is mix powders. So I've got my Hodgson Varget can here. That tells me which powder I'm using at the moment. So, you know, I can verify that with my batch sheets. I've got the Hodgson Varget in the auto charge system here, and the 4895 powder has been removed from the bench altogether, so there's no possibility of cross-contaminating my powders, especially since I'm dealing with two different powders here on this particular loading session. Now I'm going to use my auto charge to charge my cases, and whenever you're loading powder like this, when you've got your cases in a tray like this, you need to develop a pattern and use that pattern every time you charge cases. The way I do it is I start on the left and go toward the right on the first row, and then I go left to right on the second row, third row, and so on. So I always use that same pattern. Now I take my funnel and I use this as a marker, and what I'll do is I'll put this on the first case. And that tells me, you know, two things, really. One, that this case has no powder in it because it's got a funnel on it waiting for powder. and two, this is the next case to be charged. So when I drop a charge with my auto charge, I drop it into the case, I'll then immediately move my funnel to the next case. And that tells me, again, this case has no powder, and this is the next case to be charged. And I'll just do that along the way as I go, and that way I always know exactly where I am. That way I don't miss a case and end up with a squib load. If I do get called away, for instance, I'm way up here in the process, if I do get called away, I can come back and I know exactly where I'm at. I know this case has no powder and it's the next case to be charged. Now I try to arrange it so that I can do a tray of 50 all in one sitting, but things happen, and sometimes you do get called away, so you need to have some mechanism for marking where you're at, and this is the way I do it. You develop your own system, your own pattern, however you want to do it, but I highly recommend that you come up with something to tell you where you're at and what's the next case to it's getting charged, and develop that pattern. Always use that same pattern. That way there's no ambiguity as far as where you're at and which direction to go or which case is next to get charged. You do it the same way every time. You'll never have a problem with double charging or having a squib load. Now, a squib load, by the way, a few people have mentioned they don't know what a squib load is. A squib load is a cartridge that has a primer but no powder, and that's a very dangerous situation. What happens is the primer typically has just enough gas, expanding gases, to pop that bullet out of the cartridge and get into the barrel. Now, best case in that situation is that the bullet won't go far enough, and the next cartridge to go into the chamber, it won't chamber because it's hitting up against that bullet that's stuck in your barrel there. But it is possible for the primer to push that bullet far enough down that barrel so that the next cartridge will chamber. And of course you pull the trigger and very, very bad things will happen when you've got a bullet stuck in your barrel. So by developing a pattern like this and developing doing it the same way every time and knowing which case needs to be charged and which case is next, you reduce the possibility of a squib load and reduce the possibility of serious injury at the range. Okay, so I'm going to start here, and we'll get to charging cases. Okay, I've got my auto charge calibrated, and it's been warming up for about 20 minutes. You can check out my video on the Hornady powder scales to find out more about the calibration process and why I warmed it up for 20 minutes. Now I've got 4 batches to make, 10 rounds each, that use the Hodgdon-Varget powder and the Hornady match cases. So I'll go ahead and make those 4. That's a total of 40 rounds. Now the first batch here is 37.1 grains of Varget. So I know that is my target weight. And I'll hit the dispense button, and we're off to the races. Now the extruded powders are a little difficult to trickle, so I expect to get some overcharges with it. This one came out just right. I put that in the first case. I put my tub back on the auto charge, and it'll automatically fire up again and do my next charge. And I've moved my funnel to my second case here, so I know exactly where to go here. There's my second charge in the case, powder tub back on, and move my funnel. There's an overcharge. Kind of expect to get a few of those with the extruded powders. So what I'm going to do is dump that back into the hopper. I'll clear the overcharge and put the tub back on. It'll zero itself again and try again. It was only two tenths of a grain over, but when you're trying for accuracy, that's an overcharge. Yeah. Did it again. Clear the overcharge. The only problem with doing extruded powders with the auto charge is it tends to do that. There we go. Into the case. Back, tuck back on the. Oops, wait a minute. Missed two kernels there. Move my funnel, and there we go. So you get the idea. We, you know, basically I go from left to right, and then I'll go to the second row here, and that'll be a total of 10 rounds. Then I'll change the powder charge to 39.4 grains of hydrogen bargate, which is the next batch, and I'll do 10 rounds of that, and so on until I have all 40 rounds that use the hydrogen bargate and the Hornady match cases. Then I'll switch over to my Winchester cases and do the charges with the Hodgson Vargate with the Winchester cases. And I do it the same way every time. I won't make you watch me load up 160 rounds here or charge 160 rounds, but I'll get back to this and we'll see you when we're ready to seat some bullets. Okay, I've got my first 10 cases charged. Now I'm doing these one batch at a time. I've got 16 batches of 10 rounds each. If I were to load all 160 cases or charge all 160 cases, I've got two different kinds of cases, two different kinds of powders, two different powder charges. It would just be way too complicated to try to keep track of all that and which case has which charge and so on. So I'm doing these one batch at a time. Very important when you're doing developing a match grade load and you're creating all of these test batches, do them one at a time. Don't try to charge everything and then try to keep track of which case has which charge in it. It'll drive you nuts. Trust me. According to my batch sheet, the first batch takes the Hornady Bowtail Hollow Point match bullet, 168 grain. That's this bullet right here. So I'm going to be making 10 rounds with this particular bullet. Now the first step in the process, of course, is to adjust my bullet seating die. This is the Hornady custom grade bullet seating die. I replaced the standard stem, bullet adjustment stem or seating adjustment stem with the micro-adjustable seating stem for a little more accurate seating. So I'm going to put my lock and load bushing in the press, and I'm going to put a case. Now this is an uncharged case, but it's been trimmed to exactly the same length as the cases that are charged. This is one of the charges for the next batch, or one of the cases for the next batch. I'm going to I've raised the ram, and I'm going to screw the die down over top of that case. Now, the custom grade bullet seating dies from Hornady will also allow you to put a roll crimp on the bullet, or on the case. Now, this particular bullet, the Hornady 168 grain hollow point boat tail match bullet, does not have a cannelure, so I do not want to put a roll crimp on this particular bullet. You can check out my video on crimping handgun and rifle cartridges for more information about the cannelures and when to use a roll crimp, when not to, and why, and that sort of thing. So for this video and for this load, we are not going to be putting a roll crimp on there. Now I screw this down until I I feel that roll crimp component of the die come in contact with the mouth of the case. Since I don't want to roll crimp on it, I'm going to then back this out at least one turn, maybe a little more, about a turn and a quarter. That way I know that the roll crimp component of the die will not come in contact with my case. And at this point then I can lock down my locking ring. And I'll tighten the cap screw. And what this does is lock that that locking ring to my lock and load bushing so that I can pop this die in and out without having to readjust it every time. I can just pop it out, put it back in, and it's already adjusted where I need it for this particular set of cases. Now, the next step is to adjust the amount of the seating depth of my bullet. Now, the bat sheet calls for a cartridge overall length of 2.8 inches exactly. So, I've got my seating adjustment backed all the way out. I'm going to go ahead and put a bullet in, guide that up into the alignment sleeve, and then I'm going to run my seating stem down until I meet resistance, and that tells me that the seating stem has come in contact with the bullet in the case there. Okay, and I can pop it down, I can bring the ram down, and I can adjust it here. I'll get it to exactly zero there. Bring it back up and seat the bullet a little ways. Now that's obviously not in far enough, but I'm going to go ahead and measure and see how far off we are here. So I'm at 2.96 inches. So we've got little ways to go. I'm going to go ahead and run that down by another 50 there. And I'm just going to run it down like that until I get close, 2.910. Doing a little at a time. You can always run it down a little bit further, but once you've gone too far, then you've got to pull the bullet and it becomes a problem. So there we're at 2.865. We're getting closer. I'm gonna go in smaller increments now. Should take me within 10 there, or within 10 thousandths. Okay, that's 2.805, so I need 5 more thousandths. Run that 5 thousandths. And there we are, exactly 2.800. Now this micro-adjustable seating stem is just incredibly accurate. I mean, if I need 5 thousandths, I can dial it down by 5 thousandths, and that's what I get on the bullet seating or the cartridge overall length. So this bullet now is, or this cartridge is exactly 2.8 inches, which is what my bat sheet calls for. Now what I'm going to do Now that I've got a cartridge that's exactly the right length with this particular bullet, I'm going to go ahead and use my Hornady bullet comparator and measure this bullet off of the ogive. Now, the measuring it from the head to the tip of the bullet is problematic. There's a lot of things that, a lot of variables that that introduces, and you don't get an accurate measurement every single time. The tip of the bullet could have lead on it, and some of the bullets may have that lead compressed a little bit. The AMAX bullet has a flexible tip on it, so you might push down too hard with the caliper and end up, you know, some bullets will be a few thousandths off. So it's always better to measure off the ogive of the bullet to the case head as opposed to the case head to the tip. So this cartridge now from the head of the case to the ogive is 2.318. Now I'm going to record that both on my batch sheet and in my Reloaders Workshop software, and that will that way I know that if I'm using this particular bullet again with 2.8 inch cartridge overall length, I know what the ogive overall length will be, and in the future I can just measure off the ogive right off the top. So I'm going to go ahead then and start seating my bullets here. Take the next bullet. Seat that one. And I can use my bullet comparator. Make sure that I am getting same length here. Looks like my .318. So I can start cranking them out now. For all 10 bullets in this batch. And once I have that, then we'll talk about trimming. All right. Okay, I've got all 160 rounds loaded up now. I've got my Hornady box and my Winchester box. Each box has 80 rounds. And each row of 10 in these boxes is a different load. Now, I've marked on my batch sheets here, for instance, the Hornady box, row 1, is the 168 grain Bowtail hollow point match bullet from Hornady, the Hornady match case, and 37.1 grains of Hodgdon Varget. Say the Hornady row 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Is also the 168 grain Bowtail hollow point match bullet. It has 38.3 grains of IMR 4895 with the Hornady match case. So it's very important from this point on now that I keep these cartridges in the proper row, in the place that I've got them in the boxes, so that they match up with what I've got on my batch sheet, so I can take my batch sheets here out to the range, and I can record muzzle velocities and things like that as I shoot each round. And of course, you know, it's important to know, of course, which round I'm shooting. You know, here's the ones with the Hornady AMAX bullets here. I got two rows here and two rows here. One with the Hodgdon Varget, or two rows with the Hodgdon Varget, and two rows with the IMR 4895. So it's very important at this point, since, you know, we're talking about 8 different loads here, that I keep track, I keep the bullets in the right spot on the boxes. Now that I've got everything loaded up, I'm going to go ahead and go through my crimping procedure, and then we'll move on from there. So let's get to crimping. Now, I'm going to use a taper crimp on my cartridges here. Now, if you've watched my video on crimping handgun and rifle cartridges, you know that all handgun cartridges require some kind of crimp. Taper crimp at the very minimum, just to remove the belling or the flaring of the case mouth that you do with pistol cartridges, so that the bullet will get down into the mouth of the case proceeding. Even when you're roll crimping a pistol cartridge, the roll crimp die still has a taper crimp component, because before it can do the roll crimp, it has to bring the or get rid of that belling or flaring of the case. So taper crimping is done on basically on all handgun cartridges, but like I said, even if you're roll crimping, the roll crimp die has some amount of taper crimping, more or less, or something similar to taper crimping, just to get the bell out. With rifle cartridges, you don't often hear about taper crimping. Since you don't flare the mouth of a rifle cartridge, there's no need to remove the flare or the belling, because it's just not there. When I do semi-auto cartridges or rifle cartridges, I'll typically use a bullet that has a cannelure, and I'll do a roll crimp simply because the semi-autos are a little tough on the bullet, as far as trying to push the bullet down into the case as it's being slammed up into the off the magazine and into the chamber. Also, on tubular magazines, you've got the bullet, you know, nose to butt kind of in the tube there, and the firing of the round that's in the chamber and the spring that's on the that's in the tube can kind of compress those bullets a little bit, and you want to get a little more a little better hold on the bullet, so that it doesn't get compressed down into the case. Now, these cartridges are for a bolt action rifle, so there's no need really to do a crimp, a roll crimp, and the bullets I'm using don't have a cannelure anyway, so I would not want to use a roll crimp on these. Now, a lot of rifle reloaders don't put any crimp at all on their cases, and that's perfectly fine. In my experience, I don't know, I seem to have a little better luck when I taper crimp my rifle cartridges, if for nothing more than to try to even out the neck tension all the way around on that bullet. I want the same tension or similar tension all the way around. Now, I've kind of achieved that by making sure that my neck wall thickness is the same all the way around. I've turned the necks on the ones that that need it, and that'll help between the sizing of the neck down to 3/36 thousandths, and seating the bullet. That gives me a relatively even tension all the way around. But I like to taper crimp as well, and that just gives me a little more assurance, in my mind anyway, that I have the same neck tension, or kind of even out the neck tension all the way around. So I'm going to use the Loadng micrometer taper crimp die. This one's for 308 Winchester. Again, some manufacturers have taper crimp dies for rifle cartridges. Not all do. I like the Loadng version because it has the micro-adjustable taper crimp adjustment at the top. So this is the one that I use. Now, Lee factory crimp dies, taper crimp dies are also good ones. You know, there's a lot of good manufacturers out there. This is the one that I use. Anyway, in order to adjust this now, first thing, as with any die, you need to determine how far down into the press you need to screw the die. So I've got my lock and load bushing installed here. I'm going to raise the ram all the way to the top, and I'm going to run the die down until it touches the shell holder. Right there. And then once I've got that, I'm going to back it off about a half a turn. Just because I don't need the thing touching the shell holder. I'm just going to raise it up just a little bit. And tighten my locking ring. And I'll also tighten the cap screw here. And that'll lock my die to the lock and load bushing. Now I replace the locking ring that comes with the Redding die with the Hornady locking ring for a couple reasons. One, the locking ring that comes with the Redding dies have a screw that goes right into the straight into the side of the die and into the threads. And even though it's got a little, I know it has a little soft spot on there, on the end there, so it doesn't damage your threads. It is possible if you over-tighten it to damage your threads. I don't care if there's a lead dot on there or not. The Hornady locking rings do it a little differently. They have a gap here, and it squeezes the locking ring onto the die, so there's nothing actually going into the threads. The other more important reason I use the Hornady dies is because they work with my die wrench. The Redding locking ring is perfectly round and I can't use my wrench on it. So now I can use my wrench to pop the die in and out without having to readjust it every time. Now, another advantage of the lock and load bushing, there is a mark on the die body that I can use to line up with the marks on the micro adjustable crimp adjustment here. Now the problem with screwing something in all the way and then backing it out a half a turn is the mark ends up on the back there. So with a lock and load bushing or with other manufacturers that have a similar kind of device, I can turn the die around so that the mark is in the front. And now I can see the mark, and I still have the same adjustment. So that's one of the reasons I like the lock and load style bushings here, that I can turn the die around and get those marks. The same issue exists with the micro adjustable seating die. You know, the mark may end up on the back there, so I can turn the die around. If you've got a press that doesn't have that kind of mechanism, and you just have to screw the die in and the mark ends up on the back, you're just going to have to live with it, and you'll have to look around the back to do your adjustments. Okay. Now, I'm going to take the cartridges directly from the box to the press, do the taper, and then put them right back in the box where they came out. If you remember from the last segment, I have to make sure these cartridges remain in the box in the right place because I've got 8 different loads in that box and I don't want to mix them up, so I can't just dump them into my bins here. I have to go from the box to the press and back right back to the same spot in the press or in the box. Now I'm going to back out the taper crimp adjustment as far as I can get it here. Put in a couple threads. I'm going to take my first round, put in the shell holder, and run that up to the top. And then I'm going to run my adjustment knob down until I just start to feel some resistance, right about there. Okay. That means that the taper crimp component of the die has come in contact with the case mouth. And I run the case back down, and I'm going to run it in about 20 thousandths. So, about 20 thousandths. Run that back up. Not a lot of resistance there. You don't need a lot of taper crimp. You don't need to run it all the way down. I just want to get a little bit around the mouth there. I'm going to run that down another 20. And I'll just keep checking the crimp until I get to about where I want it to be. Right now I'm about 60 thousandths, and that I think will do it. What that does is for me is, like I said, I in my opinion anyway, and your mileage may vary, different people will tell you different things and based on their experience, and you need to go on your experience too, whether or not you're going to crimp at all, how much taper crimp to apply, things like that. You can also over taper crimp, so you want to be careful of that. You can watch my video on crimping handgun and rifle cartridges to tell when you're over taper crimping, tell you how to determine if you are or not. Okay, so I'm happy with the taper crimp I'm getting right here at that setting. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to run all my cartridges through taper crimp die. And get a nice little taper crimp on them and get that neck tension evened out. Now, since all of the cases are trimmed to exactly the same length, I should be getting about the same amount of taper crimp on each of my cartridges. So, let me finish this up. And then we'll be ready for the final operation on this batch of cartridges. Okay, the last operation I'm going to run on these batches is I'm going to run through my concentricity gauge, and this will allow me to remove any run out of the bullets in the that I've loaded here. Run out is basically if the bullet is tilted slightly one way or the other in the case. You want them to be perfectly concentric with the center line of the case itself. The bullet and the case should have the same center line. Now you can check out my video on the Hornady concentricity gauge for information on how to set this up and you know how it works and all of that. But I'm going to go ahead and start running some cases through. Now let me zoom in on the dial here if you can see that. And we'll check the concentricity on a few cases here. Go ahead and insert a bullet or a cartridge. Zero that out. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to rotate the bullet very slowly towards me and see how far out of alignment this bullet is. Now this one's looking pretty good. That one's under half a thousand, so I am tickled pink with that one. Let's see what we get on the next. Lowest value there, and let's see where we get. There's half a thousandths, and then it goes back to zero. So half a thousandths is good. I try to keep mine under one thousandths. If they go over a thousandth, then I try to I use the concentricity tool as a little dial on here. I can run up into the bullet and it'll attempt to fix that run out. Zero that on the lowest setting. That one goes almost to a thousandth and then goes back down. So again, it's under a thousandth, about a thousandth. So that one's good. So basically gonna run them all through the concentricity gauge. and make sure I don't have excessive run out on any of the bullets. Now, this is the last operation I'm going to run on this batch. Now, in phase two, really all I'm trying to do is find a bullet and powder that my particular rifle likes best. Now, in phase three, when we move, we find that magical combination of bullet, powder, and case, we'll move on to phase three, and then we're going to start weighing the bullets, weighing the cases, maybe trying different primers, things like that. Now, at the same time that we're doing this, for those of you who watched phase one of my Developing a Match Grade Load series, I'm running more cases through phase one to get them fire formed. I've got some Lapua cases and Nozzler cases, I believe, is the next batch. Lapua, I guess they pronounce that in Europe. But I'll be running those through phase one, and then as these guys move into phase three, the Lapua and Nozzler cases will be going through phase two, and then phase, you know, and so I've got a set of cases or a set of cartridges going through phase one, phase two, and phase three all at the same time. So it's a constant flow of testing different batches, different loads, different bullets, and so on and so forth. So typically the cases will only go through phase one once, and then they'll go into phase two. Maybe I'll move them to phase three. If they don't work out there, then I'll move them back into phase two and kind of repeat that process. But for this set of batches anyway, it's time to head out to the range and see what each of these eight different batches, and I've got a Winchester box as well, so I've got eight batches in that box. So a total of 16 batches, 10 rounds per batch. And it's time to go back and, you know, go out to the range and check them out. And that'll be on the next video.
That's all for this video. I hope you liked it. If so, please click the like button. Maybe even subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and happy reloading.